lost in the listening distance as Dark locks in. Nightfall. Good evening. When listening to tonight's program, you would be well advised to try to keep ahead of yourself. Of course, it won't do you any good, because it's going to keep happening to you anyway, in its own good time. It's a play based on the classic story by F. Marion Crawford and dramatized by Guy Babineau, and it's called The Screaming Skull.
It scream, you know. I'm not nervous, mind. I'm not imaginative, and I've never believed in ghosts. Unless that thing is one.
Well, Braddock, if it's alive, what is it then?
Whatever it is, it hates me almost as much as it hated my friend. Poor old Pratt. Like enough, that sound was the last thing he heard on Earth. I reckon he must have been glad to die.
What did you say?
You know, Dotson, old shipmate.
Well?
Now, it screams at me.
Huh?
I know. You're going to ask what it has in for me, eh? You see, it's because it thinks I did something right terrible to it. Something has took it off before its time.
And did you?
I started it. God help me, it was just a story. I never knew.
Tell me.
It was about 6 months ago in this very house. Her house. Melissa's. Everything Pratt had came from his wife, you know, and don't think she ever let him forget it.
You don't sound like a great admirer of poor Mrs. Pratt.
She was no friend of mine. I knew him from the old days, you see. And he was nothing but a ship's doctor, and she, the grand English lady, picked him up like he was a fancy souvenir on her grand trip.
I never heard of a ship's dock that was a bargain yet.
You're a hard man, Dawson, for all your smiling.
Then why, Braddock, did you ask me, plead with me, to get down from Halifax as fast as I'm here?
Because I can't stay alone with it. You're the only one left I can tell. The only one I can ask what to do.
Very well, Braddock, old shipmate. Ask.
The house was wrapped in a dirty great fog that night. It seeped right into the dining room and muddled the lamplight like the warm lee of an iceberg. But an iceberg would have been cozy compared to Melissa. Though the Lord Jesus knows I never wished her anything but a long life and a happy one. To your health and good fortune, Melissa. Luke, a long life and a happy one.
A long life.
Not joining us in a glass of brandy, Melissa.
Just coffee, thank you. Captain Braddock, if you had been accustomed to the best English society and found yourself marooned among a bunch of Nova Scotian fishermen, you'd think you had very little to drink to either.
Our people aren't fancy like London, Melissa. But they're good folk all the same. And you've got the most beautiful house here on the whole Atlantic shore.
My grandfather made sure it was when he built it, Captain. But he was careful to retire to England.
This coffee is awful.
Well, Luke, my dear, I'm so sorry. Mrs. Lowry?
Yes, ma'am?
Dr. Pratt needs another cup of coffee.
But he's scarce touched the one I just gave him.
Then you'd better pour him a fresh cup, hadn't you?
As you wish, ma'am.
That will be all, Mrs. Lowry.
Thank you, ma'am. Very good, ma'am.
You see, Braddock, my wife is trying to poison me. She'll succeed someday. Then she can leave the colonies here and play the great lady. in London.
Come now, Luke. I'm sure Melissa's too clever to get rid of you in such an obvious way.
Murder's a rather obvious act, surely.
Oh, they have ways of disposing of unwanted people in some parts of the world. I've had crew members brought back dead from shore leave now and again. I'd like to see the policeman who could prove they were murdered. But they were. I swear they were.
Oh, Braddock.
Well, now, you know, there are tricks with spun glass and silk handkerchief. Oh, and there was that woman in Ireland. Did for three husbands before anybody suspected the thing. Have you never heard of her?
No, really?
Her fourth husband managed to keep awake and caught her, and she was hanged.
Well, what do you expect from the Fog Irish?
I apologize, Braddock. My wife wouldn't kill anyone. She just snubbed them and expect them to die of shame. Go on. Tell us how the woman did it.
She drugged the husbands and poured melted lead into their ears when they were asleep.
That must have hurt a good deal.
It would have been very quick, you know.
Brain tissue's quite soft, Melissa. Speaking professionally, I would guess there might be time for
a scream, dearest. One short, sharp scream.
Well, Braddock, cat got your tongue.
Parson, this isn't easy for me to tell, you see. Mrs. Pratt died not long afterward.
Did she now?
She did. Right sudden in her bed, Pratt found her in the morning.
Bad thing for Pratt.
It was, very.
Heart attack, do you think?
Pratt said she'd had a weak heart for a long time, but he was careful. He got a second opinion.
A what?
Another doctor, just for the form of it, of course.
Of course. And the other doctor said?
He was, he was some puzzled.
But he didn't say anything?
Oh, well, there was nothing wrong, as you could see. And they were both doctors. Like old shipmates, Dawson. Do you see, Dawson?
Just so, Braddock. Shipmates.
Mm-hmm. Well, of course, I came down from Halifax right away. Pratt and I were shipmates, too, remember? That's why I didn't say anything when the police came.
Captain Braddock?
Yes, what is it?
Sergeant McAllister, County Sheriff's Officer. Just a couple of questions, if I may. It's about the late Mrs. Pratt.
I don't understand.
Standing orders, Captain. We're always interested in unusual deaths, you know.
Mrs. Pratt died of a heart attack. She'd had a weak heart for years.
Yes, so Dr. Pratt tells us. Did you see any evidence of this yourself, Captain?
I'm not a doctor.
No, but you were a friend of the family. It's common knowledge in the village that the Pratts had a pretty miserable time of it. Isn't that so?
They had the ordinary differences any married couple might have, no more.
Captain Braddock, I want you to think back to the times you've been a guest here. Was there ever even touched on any conversation about unusual death? Any odd remarks, out of the way interest in the subject?
I don't know what you're talking about.
You're sure?
I'm sure.
Thanks a lot, Captain. You've been a real help. I hope someday we can be of some help to you.
I used to come and see Pratt now and then. He looked, well, there was something about him right terrible. The last time I came down turned out to be the last time I ever saw him alive. The skin, it was stretched real tight over his face. He looked a lot like a skull.
No, don't sit there.
What? What is it, Pratt?
I'm sorry, Braddock. That was her chair. I still can't.
Of course, of course. It was stupid of me.
My nerves are not what they were.
We've been friends for years, Luke. You don't need to explain to me.
Friends, yes. You've been a good friend to me. I've heard how you stonewalled the police when they came nosing around. Told them how everything was lovely in the garden.
Oh, yes. Lovely.
Thanks to you, they went nosing away again. like good dogs. Thanks to you.
I only told
them. I know what you told them. This was Melissa's house, you know. She never let anybody forget. We had no children. You're my oldest friend. From her to me. And now I've left this house and all its contents to you.
Pratt, for God's sake, you mustn't talk as if you're going to die.
Mustn't I? Well, we'll see. I owe you something, Braddock. Shall we say, you've earned this house twice over.
Pratt, what are you...
You're retired from the sea now. No money. You don't want to rot in some sailor's rest in Halifax. Listen. You can still hear the surf from this house. I think you'll like it. Mike, I promise you will.
I wondered what he meant. For the words slipped out as he couldn't help himself saying them. But I think I've understood since.
You mean about that noise?
You heard it yourself, Dawson. It's not just the noise, is it now?
The scream. Have it your own way.
I've something to show you. You've seen this kind of thing before, Dawson.
It's a ladle. Iron. Right new, too. Never been in the fire but once or twice.
And there's something in the bowl, wouldn't you say?
It's a little coating of metal in the bottom. Gray with some hardened dross on it.
Come about, you bloody fool. You know damn well what it is.
So I do. It's melted lead. Well?
I found the ladle in the cupboard in Pratt's dispensary.
That proves nothing.
No, of course. A country doctor, he has to be a handyman. Does everything himself. Home repairs.
No, wait for the hall clock, perhaps.
Luke was a great fisherman, you know. He may have cast a sinker for a night line.
So you said nothing to anybody. Once again, you said nothing.
I said nothing. You understand, don't you?
Pratt's dead and gone. Buried beside his wife as his only right and proper.
Yes.
With an honest man's tombstone at his head. Why stir up anything that could hurt his memory? That's your idea?
Well, of course. You see, I didn't. But you?
It's a snug house, Braddock. Your house now.
Mine now.
Pratt's been dead. How long is it, Braddock?
3 months.
And you've been in possession all that time? Are you used to it yet?
Hardly.
Pratt's death was in all the Halifax papers. Real 9 days wonder they made of it, too.
Aye, and well they might. The last day of my visit, when it turned out to be the day I came into my inheritance. Mrs. Lowry, the housekeeper, she woke me at dawn and hurried me down to the beach. Pratt must have been there most of the night. But he was in no hurry to leave, you see. He wasn't going to have any more business anywhere else. Not him.
Please, sir, let's get him and fetch the police.
All right.
There's nothing to be done for him. Come on. Careful there. Keep clear of his footprints. The police will be one to look at them.
Captain Braddock, look.
What is it?
It's Dr. Pratt's footprints in the sand, sir. It looks like he was walking on his toes.
Oh, no, I don't think he was.
Then what then?
He was running, Mrs. Lowry, running for his life.
Running for his life. And the police and the coroner, then. What did they think?
The coroner's verdict was death by the physical agency of some person or animal unknown.
Well, covers the ground, doesn't it?
They did everything imaginable. Forensic experts from Halifax, Boston. The coroner's jury sat for weeks, and that was all they dared conclude.
And what happened to...
The skull?
Yes. Did you maybe pitch it into the sea?
Certainly not. It was Pratt's own property. Doctors do all sorts of things that would make men like you and me feel uneasy. He'd been carrying it for study, probably. It was clearly his in any case, so they...
They gave it back to you?
They brought it back to Pratt's house.
Which you inherited?
Yes.
So she's here?
It, not she. It's upstairs in her bedroom. You've heard sounds from there.
Yes. What do you think?
I don't believe in evil spirits.
No?
No. There may be ghosts or not. I'd rather face any shape of a ghost than a fog in the Grand Banks. No, what it was bothered me was just a damn fool idea, that's all.
That the skull might just possibly be hers, Mrs. Pratt?
Well, you see, if it really was hers... I don't say it is, mind you. Pratt might have been afraid...
That someone might find a lump of lead in that skull.
The Irish case, you know. The one I told him, them, about. They dug up the three skulls, and there was this small lump of lead rattling about in every one, and something like a burn inside on the bone. That's what hanged the woman.
And Dr. Pratt remembered? You mean he was destroying the evidence?
I wish I could believe that.
But that makes no sense. The skull was well enough hidden in the grave. The police were off track. He was perfectly safe. Now, why should...
For his pleasure.
What?
I keep trying to believe he was covering his tracks some way. I can't make it stick. There was a skull on his dispensary shelf for a while. I think he may have cleaned off the head and set it up there so he could poke with it, get his own back at last, you see.
Good God. But he was found with it out on the beach.
Yes, I think he'd gotten scared after all. He was going to throw it out to sea, maybe. I think maybe it had started to scream at him.
We don't know that.
No.
Braddock.
Yes.
Do you remember when we were boys together before the mast on the old Demeter?
Yes, what about it?
Only that you've already seen uncanny sights. We've sailed on a haunted ship. Remember at night in the Demeter, there was an extra crewman high up in the shroud?
Captain always said it was the wind.
And never looked up to sea?
If you've something to say, man, out with it.
Get rid of her.
Good God, don't you think I've tried? It wants to be there. In its place, in the cupboard, in the bedroom.
Her bedroom, where she died.
As long as it's there, it only screams. But if I try to put it out, or bury it, it comes back.
Well?
You see, I'm alone here. Mrs. Lowry lasted longer than any of the other servants. After Pratt's death, she stayed on with me as long as she could.
Then she heard it, too.
Oh, much worse than that. She saw... One night, I tried to sleep in our room. It was the best room in the house. I didn't see why I should give it up for something that never slept anyway. But it wouldn't let me have the room. It made itself felt somehow till I went right crazy, I think, and I tore it out of its cupboard and I flung it out into the night. Make it stay away. Please. Make it be lost in the tide. I didn't mean to tell him how to kill you. No. Oh, no. Go away. Go back to your own bed in the churchyard. Is it that you don't want to be near him? Is that why you won't go to your grave?
word. We'll dig up his coffin. Now you go back. You won't have to lie beside him.
Please.
All right. All right. Can you no leave a body sleep at night?
No. Mrs. Lowry, don't answer. For God's sake, don't answer the door.
Knock down the door, you damn fool. I'm coming, I tell you. I'm coming.
Don't open the door. Mrs. Lowry, what is it? What in God's name have you done?
It got in.
What got in?
It rolled against the foot. The instant I opened the door.
Light a candle, damn it.
And see it? Whatever it is, full in the light? Oh, no, Captain Braddock, sir. I'll no stay another second in this devil's house. I've had my fill of vogels and spirits. You can send my things to my cousin in the village.
Mrs. Lowry, come back.
Run, you fool. Remember the doctor's footsteps in the sand. Run for your life.
You can't leave me alone. You can't. Lord Jesus, I'm alone with... All right, Braddock. Be man. You're alone in the house with a piece of bone, nothing more. We'll close the door and put it back where it came from. Close the door, Braddock.
Now, so that's why you called me in such a hurry. Good thing you're only in Eastern Passage. How long ago did your housekeeper leave?
Last night.
Braddock, old friend, shipmate.
Yes.
Why in hell don't you get out of this place? Take Mrs. Lowry's advice. Give it back to the lady of the house.
This is my last command. I never deserted a ship in my life.
Your deckhand here, she is captain.
Damn you.
You won't run and you won't fight. Am I supposed to respect you for just standing still and shaking? In all our years at sea, I never saw you paralyzed.
Dawson, take the candle. We're going upstairs.
Once to joke, but you shouldn't be playing a trick like this. Braddock, where is your head?
Thank you. just heard The Screaming Skull, the short story by F. Marion Crawford, dramatized for Nightfall by Guy Babineau. Featured in tonight's cast were David Bulger as Captain Braddock, Joseph Rutten as Captain Dawson, and Rosemary Gilbert as Melissa Pratt. Luke Pratt was played by John Dunsworth, and you heard Florence Patterson as Mrs. Lowry and Al Foster as Sergeant McAllister. The recording engineer was Rod Snidden, with sound effects by Dermot Kenny and Harold Porter. The Screaming Skull was produced and directed at CBC Halifax by Elizabeth Fox. The executive producer of Nightfall is Bill Howell. And now, here is a final word from your host.
Hello again. Next week on Nightfall, we'll be asking you to keep your ears open for a particular kind of telephone call. Of course, we wouldn't dare tell you who's on the other end of the line.
Hello.
Is Mr. Agostino there?
What? What did you say?
Mr. Agostino.
I heard you. Why are you calling again?
God, I'm sorry, lady, if I got you again.
Yes.
I had another couple of numbers I could call, and I didn't see that I was dialing you again. I'm sorry, okay?
Yeah, okay?
I'm really sorry.
It's all right.
Anyway, I've got a confession to make, you know, about Mr. Agostino. I made it up.
You what? Listen, what are you playing at?
Mr. Agostino, a new play by Janet Benelli, starring Nancy Beattie and Tom Hoff, and directed in Toronto by William Lane. Radio that continues to hang you up without hanging up on you. That's next week on Nightfall. Until then, careful of the edge.